Now, our next speaker is Amma.
Okay, this is the tallest I've ever been, but I wouldn't be standing here in your presence if it wasn't for three important people: my mom, my brother, and God, because, man. My life has been a crazy roller coaster, and I thank my mom for, one, giving birth to me, but just dealing with a crazy and tiring child like myself, because to be honest, I don't know how she did it. There are many things I wanted to stand here and talk about, starting from my tumultuous freshman year to how I navigated being a Brooksian, but as I sat on my computer with my Suseda history paper, struggling and half complete, an idea popped into my head: friendship and maturity. Over the course of my life, one thing that I've struggled with the most socially, surprisingly, was friendship. I've always been an easy person to connect with and talk to, and I always find myself in the dining hall in between intriguing conversations about people and things I don't know, with people I don't know. But I'm a fiend for the tea, as some may say, but in all seriousness, friendships have been hard for me, and it encompasses so many dynamics of my life, so let me explain. As most of you probably know by now, I'm a first-generation Ghanaian American. My mother's an immigrant straight from Ghana. She is my ultimate best friend. But we sang songs together, we shared crazy memories, attached to the hip, of course, but even then, she's still my mom. As she may say, I'm not your mom, I'm not your friend, I'm your mom. Growing up in America with a strict African mother is a movie in itself, but in a nutshell, I wasn't raised or allowed to do certain things my friends did. I wasn't allowed to go on sleepovers. I mean, I had a bed at home, right? I wasn't able to hang out with friends after school or have play dates. And the most I did was watch ridiculous Ghanaian movies about a witch trying to kill her husband or a village girl trying to find love somehow. But I couldn't even ask because I knew those things wouldn't rock in my household. When I was younger, it would get me so upset because I just wanted to hang out with the friends that I had in class, have fun, and be normal. But little did I know, she was saving me from early heartbreak. When people think of heartbreak, they think about like their little stupid boyfriend that cheats on them and breaks their heart. But when I thought of heartbreak, I thought of my best friend in the fifth grade, April. She broke my heart. North Star Academy, Newark, New Jersey. My class had planned a field trip at the Liberty Science Center in New York. April and I were so excited because we had planned to wear the same pink jeans. The childish bliss and happiness I had back then was something I honestly took for granted. Even though she was very obviously Hispanic and I was one of the darkest girls in my grade, we thought of each other as twins, inseparable, undeniably perfect for each other, until this day. As the trip progressed and we all looked at the exhibits, lunchtime was quickly approaching. And our school had provided lunch, but the kids who were well off could buy whatever they wanted. For the first time in my life, I was content with the lunch that had been given to me. I went and sat down at the table, preserving a seat for my bestie, April. But as I bit into the sandwich, I noticed that she was sitting with another group of girls. It hurt my feelings, but I didn't think too much about it. As the day went along, she refused to speak to me, ignored me, even switched seats on the bus. She had found her clique. I remember coming home that day, crying my eyes out to my mom. April broke my heart, Mom, as she hugged me and consoled me. And from that day on, I guarded my heart and the people I let into my circle. I don't even think I spoke to April again. My mom never lets me live it down, but she always talks about how my best friend, Shekinah, closest friend of 7 years, saved me in a sense. Initially, we hated each other, and she was and still is the rudest person I've ever met, but we just eventually clicked. She defended me when people would bully me, and she didn't care about what other people said. She had a different type of confidence, the one that wasn't dependent on the people around her. She was the yin to my yang, and we stuck together through thick and thin. She's my backbone, and I her undiluted laughter. Every time I think of our friendship, I think of the time that we stayed in the Ramada Inn in sixth grade. She accidentally slapped the shit out of me while sleeping, and me, in petty fashion, slapped her as hard as I could, intentionally. Even though the night ended in laughter and busted pillows, I knew I could do everything with her, for her, except be her bedmate. As I got older and wiser, I made the decision to be intentional with my actions, just as intentional as that slap. But most of the times we go through life doing things involuntarily and expecting it from people without working for it. It goes for love, trust, appreciation, respect, and integrity. I've been intentional with the ones close to me, or at least I've tried to. I no longer love or associate myself with people because I feel like I have to. I no longer assimilate or follow a crowd because I feel like I need to. I won't agree with people because it will make them feel comfortable. And I definitely won't do things because it makes me seem nicer or cool. I do things because I want everyone to know that the person that I presented to them was genuine and unapologetically me. I got to the point where I didn't even speak to people after they offended me. And Jay knows because I stopped talking to him all of sophomore year. I made it a point to be the best friend I could be. I set boundaries for myself, and my uncle always told me that he didn't speak too often because his words were special and precious, and he didn't waste his breath on people who didn't matter. So let me shout out those who do matter. The whole BSU community, I love every single one of you. I spent my last 4 years fighting for you guys, and to be honest, you guys helped me on my rainiest days. You guys show up for me when others don't, and I love y'all so much. Stay Black. Miss Bender, Miss McDowell, Mr. King, Mr. Bay, Miss Brennan, thank you for being there for me through the toughest times and checking in on me when you didn't even know I needed it. Miss Reese, who's like my second mom, I love you so much. And you've pushed me even more than I thought I needed. And you made my experience all the more special. To Eleanor and Mari, thanks for listening to my rants, wiping my tears, participating in impromptu photo shoots in Love Island in the common room. And thanks to my other Brooks friends and friends for home for keeping me sane. And I will not apologize for being the funniest friend you have. I will list you all, but we would be here all day. And now I'm crying, so I feel very uncomfortable. To my brother for being the driving force. He's so cute. Not anymore. Thanks to my brother for being the driving force and blessing me with the best sibling in the world, even though we fight all the time. And finally, to my mom, who's my sun and my moon, my God and my protector, and the reason why I work so hard. Life is too short to care about frivolous things, and it is too meaningful to not make an impact. I realize that in this life, you cannot survive if you do not defend yourself, but you also can't live if you don't make yourself happy. Look at life half full instead of half empty. Focus on things you can control. Be intentional. Make friends. Be nice. Make a change. Thank you.